How is it going, everyone? Today, I'm here with my PWG Mystery Vortex 4 Blu-ray review. First and foremost, I know it's been a long time since I've said PWG and review in the same sentence. Long story short, I have a very long list of to on my watch list, and honestly, PWG's kind of been on the bottom of that watch list. Everything's pretty much been prioritized over it, and that's honestly the short story about it. That's why I haven't reviewed any shows. I've just been watching other things over that, and I know I'm behind. I'm slacking. After this, I now have three other shows to watch to be fully caught up, and yeah, I'm gonna be watching them, reviewing them, so stay tuned for those on my channel soon. But this video is about Mystery Vortex 4, and I'm finally here with my review. So without a further ado, let's just jump right into the video with my review of it. So of course, as always, you have the artwork on here, which I think is very, very nice on this Blu-ray. You have the Mystery Vortex 4 logo in the background. You got Marty Scurll, Zack Sabre Jr., and Rick Knox right there. And you got Chuck Taylor taking a big boot from Adam Cole right there. Pretty nice cover. Pro Wrestling Guerrilla's Mystery Vortex 4, December 16th, 2016, Rosita, California. Looks like they got rid of the adjectives to describe the shows because it just says PWG Mystery Vortex 4, so that kind of sucks to get rid of that, but what can you do? So, nice artwork cover. Open it up, got a picture of Marty Scurll right there, and you got Pete Dunne and Matt Sydal on the inside. So, some nice artwork. Here's a spine, what looks like on your shelf. If you put it there, you got Mystery Vortex 4, the picture of Kyle O'Reilly. And then here's the back. Of course, you have pictures pretty much giving a preview of the event, what to look forward to when watching this show. Some nice pictures as always. And of course, you have the back with the description as well as a match card. On December 16th, 2016, Pro Wrestling Guerrilla closed out the year with Mystery Vortex 4 in enigmatic Rosita, California. Mystery Vortex 4 on Blu-ray features seven gargantuan matches, including, and of course there is a match card. So let's place that right there. And overall, I gotta say about Mystery Vortex 4, I thought it was a really good show. Was it a PWG show match, the show of the year contender? I don't think so. I feel like the first half, very slacked. I thought it slacked. It just was very underwhelming. Nothing really that good happened in the first half, but the last three matches honestly saved this show and made it really good. So, second half of the show was great. Really enjoyed the last three matches, but the first half were disappointing and just very, you know, good to average matches. Nothing really special, if you ask me, so. Solid show, solid way to go out, but definitely wasn't a show of the year contender for 2016 or anything like that, so that's my thoughts on that. Show opened up with Candice LeRae versus Trent. This was a good, fun opener. You know, of course, Trent pretty much was playing the fact that Candice LeRae is a girl, so he was not taking her seriously. He was doing things he didn't want to do. You know, Candice would just fire up and go off on Trent, and Trent was kind of just like, you know, brush it off, not really do anything about it. And it was kind of funny. You know, Trent would give her a vicious powerbomb on the apron after Candice LeRae did a suicide dive on the outside to him, followed by a kick. And he just gave her a powerbomb, and he looked like he just contemplated life going forward. But some nice mixture of comedy and some good solid wrestling. Candice looked really good with the violence party. Hit a few reverse hurricanranas on Trent for some nice near falls. So it was some good back and forth action. Trent won with two dude busters on Candice for the win. So good opener, some nice comedy, and I felt it made Candice look really good, especially this being her return since she hasn't been in PWG in a while. So I thought she had a good showing, and Trent, I thought, just, you know, played it off like. The way he played it off the match, I thought was great as well. So, a good opener. From there, I'm going to ACH versus Trevor Lee. Right from the get-go, Trevor Lee attacks ACH. This is also ACH's big comeback at PWG. I don't remember the last time he was on a show before this, but I felt like it was very disappointing. I thought ACH didn't really deliver for the most part. I thought it was very underwhelming against him and Trevor Lee. Trevor Lee, I thought, played the great dick heel role like he's been doing for the past, I don't know, you know, like 2 years now, I guess. Or about a year and a half from the show, I guess. But Trevor Lee's been a tremendous heel. He definitely showcased it here, you know, doing broken mats moves and, you know, doing the delete chance and everything like that. So, I mean, it was a very average match. There's nothing anything besides that. Like I said, ACH, I thought, felt flat and just really didn't capitalize on his big return. And Trevor Lee ended up winning with the God's Last Gift anyway. So, average match, just very underwhelming return for ACH. Pete Dunne versus Matt Sydal was good. I felt it went a little too long, though. I just felt like nothing interesting about this match is going on. I feel like, you know, it was a very random match, and that's the whole skin of Mystery Vortex, but I don't know. I feel like this wasn't a good random. You know, Matt Sydal was fresh off of being released from Japan prison, so of course he was playing like a criminal, you know, comedy heel, I guess you can say. You know, every time the referee would get on about something, you'd be like, hey, take it easy, I don't want any trouble, man. And he didn't look that great. He looked very, you know, average at best. You feel like it definitely didn't seem like he was trying to give a mind-blowing performance. And Pete Dunne, honestly, you know, even though he looked good, he didn't look great. I feel like a lot of things he was doing was just very there, you know, nothing what he was doing seemed very crisp or smooth. It just, I don't know. It seemed like he was being kind of safe. He wasn't really being the bruiserweight that I know him as. So I don't know. I felt disappointed from both ends. There's some nice counters. Pete Dunne was able to counter a moonsault into a tombstone. Matt Sydal was able to counter the bitter end into a DDT. And also hit a reverse hurricanrana, which was nice. Matt Sydal ended up hitting with the kendo stick, which would lead to a shooting star, which got reversed when Pete Dunne put his knees up. Went for the bitter end, but Matt Sydal was able to get out of it and hit a reverse hurricanrana one more time, followed by a shooting star press for the 1-2-3 victory. So good action, just went on way too long, and it just, for the match, for the length it got, it should have been way better. Speaking of which, it should have been way better. Death by Elbow, JT Dunne and Chris Hero versus Red Dragon, Bobby Fish, and Kyle O'Reilly. This was a good solid match, but it went on way too long. It was like 25 minutes, and I just felt like, it was just, the action was there. It wasn't a dull moment, but for the time they got and the two teams that they are, they're both tremendous tag teams. You would have thought they would have put on a classic match, and they really didn't. It was good. That's all it really was. Like I said, there was always action in the ring. There really wasn't a moment where it was being boring. I thought Bobby Fish and JT Dunn had a nice start to the match. Bobby Fish is playing JT Dunn right in his head with a nice arm drag, which I thought came off beautifully. Then, of course, Chris Hero and Kyle O'Reilly tagged in. They went out for a little bit, and of course, Red Dragon would annihilate Chris Hero. Pretty much just working on him for the majority of the match until JT Dunn got that hot tag. And then, the match pretty much led up to, the closing moments, I should say, was pretty much just a bunch of elbows, pile drivers, and kicks, and just, an all-out war between all four men going against each other. So that's what it came down to, a big old just brawl towards the end. And of course, Kyle O'Reilly got the submission victory with the cross arm breaker on Chris Hero for the submission victory for Red Dragon. So good match. It was good action, good pace. But it was just, for the time it got and the two teams that they are, I expected a lot more. I expected a mind-blowing match, but we didn't get that. We just got a good match, and then, that's what it was. So that was that. From there, I'm going to go to a number one contender match, Adam Cole versus Chuck Taylor. This was a lot of fun. Chuck Taylor doing some great comedy from the get-go with Adam Cole. Adam Cole going to attack Excalibur for making fun of his weight. Chuck Taylor attacks him, does some comedy onto the comedy table. They go into the ring where Chuck Taylor does his infamous dive over the top ropes onto his opponent. Adam Cole lay there like he was dead. Play dead, attacked Chuck Taylor after that. And they had a really fun back-and-forth match. It really wasn't a point where it was boring. It was like a 10-minute sprint almost from both men. They just went out there, had a lot of fun, did some comedy. Of course, Adam Cole trying to do the suck my dick thing to Chuck Taylor, and Chuck Taylor would actually bite on his dick, which I thought was pretty painful on Cole's part. So that was a pretty funny spot. Cole actually hit this Panama Sunrise on Chuck Taylor. Chuck Taylor actually kicked out of it, which was a huge surprise. Chuck Taylor was actually in the bin. Actually end up hitting the awful waffle on Adam Cole for the huge surprise victory. The crowd went absolutely crazy for Chuck Taylor becoming the one contender. I don't think anyone expected it, so that's why it was a huge moment. So very fun match, Chuck Taylor, number one contender, huge moment for him, and just the crowd went absolutely crazy for that. So very fun match. This is where the show definitely started picking up. Next, we had a non-title tag team match, Jeff Cobb and Matt the Riddle versus the Young Bucks, Matt and Nick Jackson. This was an awesome tag team match here. I thought this was awesome. The different dynamic. Contrast and styles mix very, very well. Young Bucks are two small guys, and then you have Cobb and Riddle, who are two monsters. And you would think it would just be Cobb and Riddle just throwing them around, right? But no, it was actually the Young Bucks throwing Cobb and Riddle around. Nick Jackson tried to, or Matt Jackson powerbombed Matt Riddle, and then Nick tried to powerbomb Jeff Cobb, but couldn't do it. And then Matt actually powerbombed Jeff Cobb on the apron, which was pretty good. There was some nice limb work by the Young Bucks, which, might be surprising to some people. They worked on Matt Riddle's foot because, of course, he doesn't wear boots, so they targeted his foot. They super kicked his foot, which I thought was a great spot. I thought Matt Riddle's selling was superb in this match. Just a lot of great action. The crowd was red hot for it. There was one point where just everyone was going sanity, and the crowd was chanting who was legal because that's how crazy this match was. A lot of great spots. Honestly, it's probably the best that the Young Bucks have looked in PWG in quite some time. They've had some great matches in the past year or two, but I feel like overall performance from bell to bell, I feel like this has been the best performance they've had in a tag team match. So this was great. Honestly, it was probably the match I had the most fun with watching. Like I said, the contrast of styles were great. Eventually, Jeff Cobb with the hot tag, some nice near falls. The Young Bucks going for more bang for your buck. But of course, one of Cobb and Riddle rail to stop the finish from happening. And I just thought it was tremendously fun. And the finish saw, I believe, Matt Riddle hit a Bro to Sleep on Matt Jackson, which was followed by A Tour of the Islands by Jeff Cobb for the 1-2-3. So Cobb and Myrtle get the surprise victory. Very huge win for them, yet they have yet to get a tag team title match, which doesn't make any sense, but what can you do? Very fun tag team match. Like I said, honestly, the match I had the most fun watching on this show, so definitely an awesome tag team match. And then we go to the main event, which was the World Championship title match. Zack Sabre Jr. being the champion versus the villain Marty Skrull being the challenger. Tremendous main event here. Definitely a PWG Match of the Year contender for 2016. I feel like from bell to bell, it was just great wrestling from both men. The first half of the match was very mat technical base. A lot of great submissions, a lot of smooth transitions, and just a lot of great submission-based re mat wrestling going on. And then it gradually transferred into more of a regular wrestling match where they're just wrestling each other, still involving the technical wrestling portion, but being more hands-on with the maneuvers, not really being mat-based. Marty Skrull being a great heel against Zack Sabre Jr. Some really great near falls from Marty Skrull and some very close calls, with almost locking in the crossface chicken wing. So this match is 36 minutes long. It's a long match, but honestly, it breezes right by. It's one of those matches where you don't even realize how long the match is until you go back and be like, wow, that's how long the match was. It felt like it was 10 minutes, and it really breezed through. And I thought it was just tremendous wrestling from both men, and definitely, like I said, PWG Match of the Year contender. Both men are just incredible performers. Honestly, this match was better than their BOLA 2015 match, I believe it was, from stage three on the semifinals. Yeah, it was the one Zack Sabre Jr. won. So I love that match too, but this one honestly was better in my opinion. I wasn't really too much of a fan of the finish. The referee got knocked down, and Marty Skrull had Zack Sabre Jr. down for the win. But of course, seeing it the win, another referee came out. Justin Borden, the bitch, came out, and they went at it for a couple more minutes until Zack Sabre Jr. got the submission victory on Marty Skrull to win. So Zack Sabre Jr. retains his championship in a hellacious title match. Like I said, this was an awesome match. Really enjoy the stuff between both men. Great show of respect afterwards as well, with Marty Skrull giving Zack Sabre Jr. the championship. And of course, Chuck Taylor, who was on commentary for this match, gets in the ring and stares down Zack Sabre Jr., foreshadowing their title match at the next show, which was Only Kings Understand Each Other. So can't wait to watch this one. And yeah, that'll do it for my review, guys. Like I said, overall, I thought Mystery Vortex 4 was a very good show. The very first half of the show was very underwhelming. I felt like the first three matches really didn't deliver fully, and the tag team match was very disappointing. But since the number one contender match with Adam Cole and Chuck Taylor and everything going forward with the non-title tag team match and, of course, the main event, I feel like those three matches were great. And I'd definitely say this show from being possibly one of PWG's worst shows of 2016. So, yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you guys did, please leave a like below. And as always, I'll see you guys next video. Thank you guys for watching the video.